No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work.
Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Agnes Williams of Agnes Williams Ministries, here again to discourse with you on principles enshrined in the Word of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, for the opportunity one more time of ministering your word to your people. Holy Spirit, let me speak exactly what you want me to speak, that the hearers may be edified and be closer drawn to God. In Jesus' name I pray thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Today my topic is the greatest commandment, and it's taken from Matthew chapter 22. Verses 34 to 45 from the New International Version, the greatest commandment. Man makes laws and commandments, as you call it. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt do this. You have a job, there are laws and commandments as they have. There's the law of the land where you, if you're a driver, there are certain ways, places you can drive, how you have to drive, whether it's on the left hand, on the right hand, which lane you turn into. There are laws, every law or commandment. But the greatest commandment in the world for mankind is what we have here. It says here, hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Love. The romantic people sing a lot about the love, what love is. Some of them sing they don't know what love is. But the love of God transcends every other type of love in this world. And if we love God, in fact, the Bible says God is love. God is the one who created love. He is love. God is love. He is love. And if we love God, we will love people. And loving people doesn't mean that you will always allow them to do you what they want. No, no, no. You stand up for your rights. But within your heart, you don't hate them and want to do them evil. And a tit for tat, and an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. No. Love causes you to forgive people. And that does not mean that because you forgive them, you will stay within their parameters. No, you may keep out of their parameters, out of their reach. But in your heart, you don't despise them and hate them. You still love them. Because every one of us makes mistakes in this life. We are all sinners in the hands of an awesome God. And we are only saved through the blood of Jesus Christ, that we can repent of our sins and accept the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made for us upon the cross, that we'll be acceptable back to God. So the greatest commandment, he says, is love. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. You know, sometimes a young man might tell a woman, "I love you with all my heart, with all my soul." And they might get married, and then things happen in the marriage, and he treats her badly. Whether she's right or wrong, sometimes he wants to physically harm her. I've read of where people usually hurt their spouses. They get rid of them. But love, true love, the love of God does not do that. Those people should just separate and leave that one alone and go ahead or they can forgive. If they had a love of God, they either leave them alone or try to find a way to bring them on the right pathway. So how can we love, how are ways we can show we love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind? We'll base our life on the principles enshrined in the Word of God and how to live with each other, how to deal fairly with each other, that we wouldn't tell lies, we wouldn't lie to one another deliberately. Sometimes you make a mistake and you lie and you say, oh, I made a mistake. And you say, forgive me, and you try to be honest as possible. Love does not do evil to its neighbor. Sometimes people just sit and they plot and they do evil things to their neighbors and their friends and their families out of a heart of hatred, unforgiveness, envy, jealousy, malice. All those things cause you to hate and not love. And those things are not of God. You can forgive someone, but that does not mean you want to keep the person close to you. You don't have to keep the person close to you. But in your heart, you forgive them. And if an opportunity arises where you can do something to help them, you will. But you won't hold them up in your heart, and when you see them, you're angry. You bellow such dirty things from your mouth, and you curse them, and you wish you could kill them. And No. That's not godly. That's not showing the love of God. Yes, they hurt you, but you commit them to the Lord. Let the Lord, let His blood of Jesus Christ wash you and cleanse you. Let Him heal the hurt. I'm not saying you're going to keep close to that person who hurt you. I will keep far from you. But I will let the Holy Spirit teach me how to deal with you. If I see you in trouble, I may send someone to help you. I may not come. Because you may say I'm coming to hurt you. But God understands, man. There are so many ways that we could love. First of all, if we love the Lord with all our heart and our soul and with all our mind, that is the greatest commandment of all. If we truly love God, we will search the Word of God. We'll pray to God. We'll ask Him every day, how do I deal with these situations? How do I treat with all of these things that are coming my way? How do I treat my neighbors? How do I treat my brothers, my sisters? How do I treat my husband? How do I treat my wife? How do I treat my children? How do I treat my teachers? How do I treat with the other drivers on the street when they give me a bad drive? When my neighbors encroach upon my property, how do I handle it? Do I kill them? No. You find a way to manage it, and the best thing sometimes you have to resort to the law. And when the boundaries are clearly defined again, then everybody knows that the boundaries have been defined by the law of the land based on the documents that are in the laws. And so they can't say you rob them of their land, and they can't rob you, and you can't rob them. Thank God there are laws that can keep us in control and cause us to love instead of walking in hatred and malice. So if you want to really be called a lover, I exhort you, the first thing you have to do is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. You might tell me, but I don't see God. You see God in the other person. You see God in the trees, the birds, the animals, in the very air you breathe. Search the scriptures. The Bible says, search the scriptures. In them, you will know about God. There are many versions of the Bible nowadays. You find a version that suits you. If you can't understand the King James Version, try the NIV. There are all different types. There's the Jerusalem Bible. There are different versions that caters for all nations, all people, all ages. And by reading the Word of God, studying the Word of God, trying to implement the Word of God in your life, you will show God that by doing those things, you love the Lord. You will love to do good. You love to obey the laws of the land. You love to walk aright. You love to forgive. There are times you will have to keep far from certain people, but that doesn't mean that you don't love them. Love is the embodiment of the whole character of God. He says, love the Lord your God. How can we love God? We love God by worshiping Him, thanking Him for who He is. We yield ourselves to Him. We repent of our sins because we were born in sin and shaped iniquity. You find another call and you repent of your sin. Say, Father, I know I was born in sin. And ask God to forgive you of your sin. And then we do commit sin, so we ask God to forgive us. And wash us and cleanse us in the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, that was shed. I mean, all this is not a natural thing. These are spiritual things. You don't see natural blood, but it's there. Do you see God with your eyes? Yes, you see God in me. But there's an almighty God who one day when we die, we will see Him somehow. But He is there. He controls the universe. He controls life. He gives us grace, more grace. That's why He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. All the other people who they call saints and they call their names and the other gods, they have died. Or they make a statue out of stone and silver and gold and say that's a god, has no life. You have to lift it from place to place. Our God isn't like that. We don't have to lift our God from place to place. No, our God is God. He's in control of the universe. He's in control of our world. He's in control of our lives. You can experience God personally. I have experienced God personally in my life. And I thank God for the love wherewith He has loved me. He loves all of us with an everlasting love. But we have to yield to Him. We have to repent of our sins. Turn from our wicked ways. Sometimes you want to do somebody something evil to repay them. The Lord says, no, don't you do that. He tells you to do something else. You hear God speaks to all of us. Just how the devil speaks to all of us. He tells another man, kill the man. Get a gun and shoot him. Kill his child. That's the devil. That's Satan doing that. To take up a gun and shoot somebody and kill people, that's the enemy of our souls. That's not godly. So I want to encourage you today to love the Lord your God with all your heart. And the first action you can take is to study the Word of God. Read the Scriptures. The Scriptures tells you about Jesus Christ, about God, about men of God, people like King David. We heard about all these men, the disciples of Jesus Christ, all the kings of Israel. Search the Holy Scriptures. Read the Bible. You will learn about God there. The Holy Spirit will teach you. You will understand history. We go to school, we go to college, university, and we learn history. We learn the history of man. And the history of man has, there's the history of God also. How God has dealt with mankind. There are nations who did not love God, who did not honor God, and they were destroyed. But there are people who chose to believe in Almighty God and don't worship all these gods that they made with stone and gold and hands that man made. No. Our God, Almighty God, is not made with hands. He's God all by Himself. He exists by Himself. We are His servants. We are His sheep. He loves us. He made us that we could worship Him and praise Him and be with Him forever. All you have to do is repent of your sin because you were born in sin and shaped iniquity. Because we naturally know to sin. So, God is love. God loved this world that He sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, to die upon the cross for our sins, to be beaten, stripped, to pay the price on Calvary, that He could redeem us back to Him. Man had sinned, He said, I must redeem man to myself. I must find a way. And He said, I'll send my Son to die for this. And the Son said, yes, I will go. So Jesus Christ came. And He died. He lived until about 33 years old, about that age. He walked the earth like man. He grew up as a child. He was touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He knew what is it to cry. I'm sure there are times he bumps his foot against a stone. He felt the heat of the sun. The rain wet him. He had to do chores in his father's and mother's home. He learned the ways of man. But he knew that he came for a purpose. And because he was a dutiful son, he fulfilled the purpose. And he showed us mankind the great love of God through his greatest commandment, love. For God so loved the world, it says John 3:16, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I can assure you, I'm 73 years old. When I was 12 and a half, I heard the gospel preached. And I was convicted of sin. I repented of my sins. I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior and began living for the Lord. Yes, I backslid many times, ups and downs, ins and outs. But God is so great that he loves. Every time I went back to God, he took me in. And after all these years, I can testify that God's love is the greatest love on this earth. He loves us with an everlasting love. That is why he tells us we must love the Lord of God with all our heart, all our soul, and all your mind. And that is the first and greatest commandment. And then the second is to love your neighbor as you love yourself. I mean, there are times you will not allow your neighbor to do you everything wrong. They will stand up for your rights, etc. You will not go and do evil to them. You will treat them as God expects you to. God always gives you the wisdom how to treat people. Sometimes he says, just stay silent. Sometimes he tells you to answer them. Time he shows you what to do. I have been through so many experiences of the love of God that I can see that God is love. I am still striving every day and trying every day to please God, to do the things that would please him and show him I love him. He says, Jesus told him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. You know, sometimes a man tells a girl, a maiden or a young lady, I love you with all my heart. I love you with all my soul. I love you with all my mind. And during the marriage, something goes wrong. He abuses her. He physically abuses her. He abuses her financially. And women do the same thing to men. We abuse each other. But God doesn't do that. God's love is everlasting. We may be chastised for certain things. But when we repent and turn back to him, he opens his loving arms and he takes us back in. Oh, what an awesome God. What a loving God. We could love God by studying his word, repenting of our sins first of all, because we were born in sin, and then praying to him, seeking his face, studying the word of God, thinking about the spiritual things of life. And then that can teach you how to live with your daily physical life, how to live with your neighbors, how to live with your husband, your wife, your children, your brothers, your sisters. You learn. I've had a wealth of experience. Today I thank God that he has kept me alive to have seen the age of 73. I have classmates who are older than me. I have brothers and sisters who are older than me. And I thank God for his grace and his love upon me. Many times I reached the throes of death and God brought me back. A couple of times, accidents by car and drowning almost took me, and I knew the hand of God brought me back. And I thank God that I have the opportunity to love the Lord. And I still wish that I could love the Lord my God. I strive every day to love the Lord my God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind. And I try to love my neighbors myself. He says, all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments, love. You know, there are songs that say love makes the world go around. We believe that, and that is true. Love between a man and a woman, it makes the world go around. But the greatest commandment of all is to love the Lord. And if you love God, you will try to treat people well. Sometimes they treat you badly, but you may try to avoid them from treating you badly. But you wouldn't go back and always say, you're going to take a revenge. You're going to take revenge. No, you forgive them. Keep away from them. Keep out of their way. And be wise in your dealings and your transactions. God will give you the wisdom because He's the God of love. So today I present to you God's greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. You don't see Him, but you know He's there. With all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You love your neighbor as yourself. He says all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. We sing in the romantic world, love makes the world go wrong. Love, love, love. I mean, that is just love between man and woman. How much more the love between man and God? I experience the love of God so much in my life. I know God loves me with an everlasting love. I have experienced it so many times. So many times things, trouble comes my way. Disaster comes at me. And God delivers me. I feel His love. I know His love. I know the angels are there to protect me. And I thank God for demonstrating to me that He loves me. And I want to love Him with all my heart. I haven't reached yet, but I'm going to keep on trying to do the right things. I can encourage you to try. You try. Take a baby, learns to walk by taking one step at a time. Just so with us, with loving God, take one step at a time. Study the Word of God. Pray to God in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ. Forgive others when they do you wrong things. But sometimes don't put yourself in the position where they can hurt you again. You sort of keep away. But when hurts come, you don't just go and murder somebody and kill them and do them wrong things. No, we have to learn to forgive. Love forgives. Love gives one another chance. Just how Jesus Christ, God, gave us so many chances upon this earth. We have to walk with God every day. And He will teach us how to love. Because when we love Him, His love pours into our lives. And that love can be poured into other people's lives. Sometimes there are people you'll keep away from them, yes, but that doesn't mean you hate them. No, you don't hate them. If you have a chance to do good for them, you'll do good for them. But because of certain things, you keep away from certain people. They are not good for your aura, not good for your good. So today, I present to you the greatest commandment of all in life. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. And he says, all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Isn't that great? Isn't Almighty God great? Hallelujah. There may be someone out there who is willing to give your heart. You realize that you're a sinner. Willing to give your heart to the Lord to repent and turn to God. You've lived. You've done everything you could do, and you recognize, look, I need to accept, to repent of my sins. Today, pray with me. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, I come to you. I know I'm a sinner. I was born in sin. I have sinned. Lord, I repent of all my sins, God. Forgive me of my sins, O God. Wash me in the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Accept me as your child one more time, O God. Allow your Holy Spirit to dwell in me, O God. Lord, I want to walk with you. I want to learn how to love you more. Father, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to you. I repent of my sins today, O God. Forgive me and accept me as your child. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. If you have prayed that prayer, I encourage you get the Bible, start to study Bible, find a good church to go to. In fact, no church is perfect. But just go and you learn and you listen and you learn and you listen and God will guide you along. Change your companionship. Find people who love the Lord, people who go to church, who congregate together, who teach each other. Don't congregate with people who are evil, people who plan to plot and steal and kill. No. Congregate with people who do good to others and help others to please God. So today, I'm Pastor Agnes Williams, thanking you for listening. As I shared with you on principles enshrined in the Word of God, have a great day. God bless you, and may you walk with the Lord, and may you love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Have a great day. God bless you all.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work.
Greetings.